Young people, treasure these moments. Don't forget it. Treasure these moments. You're in a Christian school, a place that believes the Bible. Amen. Preaches the gospel of grace, salvation by grace, eternal security, baptism for believers. Treasure these moments. Now you're young, but if you'll think every day, thank God for every day He gives you. I mean every day. And say, Lord, I don't want to forget this. If the Lord tarries, you had to be 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80 years of age, you look back. You'll say, God bless me and God help me then. And remember this atmosphere, this church, this pastor, all you're doing. It's amazing. Now, I want you to have that. Treasure these moments. Don't lose them. Sometimes we're careless. Big things happen, we forget about them, you know. God's good to us, we can neglect. No, you remember things. Remember how God answered your prayers. Remember how God supplied your needs. Remember your associates here in the school, teachers and students alike. But remember. Now I'll give you a motto. I've been praying about it. And about your great school. I thought in my mind, a little motto for you. For this school, just, this is just for you now, not for the outside world, but for the you. 1,000 in 2,000.
That's great.
You got it? 1,000 in 2,000. When you come to the year 2,000, if the Lord tarries, I'm praying that this school will have 1,000 or more in enrollment.
Amen.
That would be, oh, not quite twice what you have now. Not quite twice. But you can do it. 1,000 in 2,000. That's not very far off. And wouldn't it be something? And if you don't mind, would you pray just one little prayer once in a while for me that I could live to see that?
Yes, sir.
Huh? I'd like to be standing right here someday when you have 1,000 enrolled in school. This building, a new one, you'll have a new one by the time, I'm sure.
Yes,
but God bless you. And make the thing real. Treasure these moments. Think of what you're doing. Don't complain. Don't find fault. Just say, Lord, thank you and help me to do my best. Study and work and pray and enjoy what God has given you. And thank God for every blessing of life. All right, open your Bibles now, please, to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. And I want you to underscore a little portion of one verse, a verse that you know quite well, but I want you to underscore it anyway. Mark it, if you will. And verse 21 of Mark chapter 10. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said to him, one thing thou lackest. Now underscore that. One thing thou lackest. Go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor. Thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and come take up the cross and follow me. And he was sad about the saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. One thing thou lackest. Let me ask you something. What is missing in your life? What is missing in your life? Be honest. I had a great friend many years ago, one of the greatest fellows I've ever known. Had a memory that exceeded anything I've ever known on the part of any man. Quote chapters in the Bible, never miss a word. I would even stand quote for 25, 30 minutes at one time. And quote, had a great mind, great memory. Everything about him was fine, a good personality. He lacked one thing. He couldn't stick to anything he'd do. When I finished, went away to my first church. I recommended him to a church in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. They heard him speak one time and called him. He stayed 3 months and left. Came back to Memphis. He said, I didn't like it. Tell me, get another place. And I looked around and searched, and I found a place over in Holly Springs, Mississippi. Never will forget it. Beautiful First Baptist Church in Holly Springs. And I recommended him. He went out and preached for them one time. They called him at once. I mean, a great personality, a splendid mind, a good voice, everything about him. Lovely. He stayed about 3 or 4 months and quit. Came back and said, I'm through. He never did a thing in the world. He died. He died at a young age of failure. Now, amen. What's missing in your life? Are you sticking to the job, sticking to the thing, doing the thing that you've set yourself to do? Highly good preacher friend. Could preach and memorize scripture. And great at that thing. And could hold the crowds. But he failed. He was weak morally. He failed in his morals. I remember our church, a good personality, a teacher of the Word of God, but one thing missing. He couldn't tell the truth. And a good man, people loved him, but he could not tell the truth. Now, Saul of Tarsus had about everything, didn't he? On that road to Damascus. A brilliant mind, a top education, a high position, respectability, but he lacked something. He did not know Christ. One thing thou lackest. I see a thousand young people, but they lack something. I go to big universities. Excuse me. I walk inside. I go to some of the special hours. They lack something. There's something lacking. You can look at the young people, look at their face and tell that. And they don't know anything about Christ. They read the Bible. State universities, big schools. They lack something. I see the rich and influential, high income people, but they lack something. I see a man like Mr. Bill Clinton. He lacks something. And he's the president of our nation. And was a Baptist. I said he was. He now goes to the Methodist church on Sunday morning when he goes. But he lacks something. Wait, I'm pointing out something to you. Now, what's missing in your life? Think of your life and be honest. And if there's something missing in your life and you say, "Dear Lord, help me to make this thing right. I want to be my best for Christ." Amen. Not halfway, but completely sold out. Number one, do you have a knowledge of salvation? Do you know you're saved? That's point number one. Have you been born again? That's more important than your denomination. More important than the Baptist or Methodist or Presbyterian or Catholic or Jew, whatever it may be. Have you been born again? Jesus said you must be born again. Paul said, "I know whom I have believed. I know. Now you should know that. And my friend, young people, know it now. And if you're not sure of your salvation, get that established today before you go on. See your teacher, see your pastor, talk to someone, but say, "I want to know that I'm saved. I'm going to heaven when I die. I want to know that Christ is in me, living in me. As Paul said, Christ liveth in me. I want to know this." Now, he must be real to you. And you must say, "Oh God, I want this to be real in my life. I want to know that I've been born again." Do you have a knowledge of yourself, or is that missing? Do doubts come in sometimes? You wonder if you are saved. I see people failing. Preachers failing, and missionaries failing. I wonder sometimes if they're really saved. I wonder if they ever faced the fact when they went to the field as missionaries, if they really understood. And can you know, "I know that Christ is mine, my Savior." I finished up radio broadcast in Chattanooga one morning. We broadcast every day at 8:30 for 40 years. I was on there every morning. And one morning a fellow came walking down the aisle. And came up on the platform. He said, "Sir, I came to tell you, I just got saved." I said, "Praise God, where were you?" He said, "McCarr, coming in from Dalton, Georgia. I heard you on the radio, and you told me how to be saved. I trusted Christ, I'm born again." He said, "Thank God I'm saved." And I said, "Wonderful." Shake hands with my penis and organ, see. Shook hands with all of them, and then came back on the platform to me. And I said, "Sir, where do you live?" And he named a town south of Dalton, going toward Atlanta, near Atlanta. I said, "Excuse me, sir." I said, "What kind of business are you in?" He said, "I am pastor of the First Baptist Church. But never saved till this morning." He said, "I know I've been born again." I went back to the church, confessed it. I'm glad to say he was baptized and they called him as pastor. Now, that'll never happen again, but we do that one time. Now, do you know you're saved? Have you been born again? That's number one. Is that lacking in you? If there's a lack in that matter of knowing that you're born again, talk to your pastor, talk to one of your teachers, get a friend of yours, open up the Bible, read John chapter 3, and get on your knees and say, "Here and now I put my faith in Jesus Christ. I want to know that I'm born again." Around 10 or 10:30 at night, when we lived back in Fairfield, Alabama, knock on the door, went to the door, there stood Mrs. Jack Stone. Mrs. Stone taught the ladies' Bible class in the First Baptist Church where I pastored. And I mean a marvelous teacher, personality plus. And she knew the Word of God, and she was a great day. People loved her. They came by the scores to hear her teach on Sunday morning. Mrs. Jackson, ladies' class. And I went to the door, and she rushed in our living room and said, "Brother Robertson, I have never been saved. I've been studying my Bible, and as I read, prepared my lesson, I discovered in my heart that I've never accepted Jesus Christ. I want to be born again." Amen. I took my Bible, led her to the Lord, and she came forward in church and was baptized. And people were shocked by it, the way she knew. She never buried throughout the rest of her life until she went home to be with the Lord. Never buried one particle. Now, is something missing in your life? If this is missing, then make sure you correct that.
Amen.
I want to know what I'm saying, number one. Number two, do you have a sense of direction? Do you have a sense of direction? A calling from God? Do you know where you're going? Do you know the purpose of your life? Has God called you? Then respond and say yes to Him.
Amen.
You see, is that lacking in your life? See, God wants to use you. He may have you on hold for a little while. You get your training, and you pray and wait on God, but He'll show you. And you can have a sense of direction. You know where you're going. You've been called of God. Now when God calls you, don't you vary one bit.
Amen.
And do what God says.
Amen.
That Sunday morning, back up in Old Cedar Creek Church in Louisville, the pastor, Brig Jan Benford, gave an invitation and said, if the young people here feel called to the full-time ministry, come forward. I went down the line. I said, "Sir, I've been called. I don't understand 18 years old, scared half to death." And I said, "I don't know what it's all about, but I surrender my life to be a preacher." He said, "Stand right here in front." And I stood up right in front of the church, and he turned to the audience and said, "This young man feels called to preach." He said, "Maybe others." He was singing a verse of a song, and it began coming until 9 of us stood there, 4 on one side of me, 4 on the other side. And we were all in tears. I never will forget. The boy next to me was crying, a good friend of mine. I'd been to his home to have dinner with him over and over again, and we'd gone to school and everything together. And he was crying, and others were there in the same way. But wait a minute, out of the 9, I'm the only one preached. 8 of them turned away. What happened to him? Well, the boy next to me, that good friend of mine, died at an early age. Never did a thing for God. And the boy on the other side of me, the last time I heard, the only one maybe living, was in a cell, a federal penitentiary, Atlanta, Georgia. There for life. He may be dead now. But the rest of them failed altogether. Now, what I'm saying, if God calls you, do what God says.
Amen.
"Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" He has an answer for you. God has an answer for you. And you take the answer and say, "Lord, I want to do your will. Your will." Had a man saved in Chattanooga named Clarence Lohner. Never will forget him. A nice personality. Story about him, much of it I could give, but will not. But one night, Clarence Lohner was sitting in a car with a girl down the across Main Street, you know, the area down there, and not far from where you were talking about living, and sitting with a girl in the car, and somebody stuck his head in the window and took a pistol and pulled a trigger and killed him. And I heard about the divorce. I rushed to the family, and then I went to see the young lady who was sitting with him in the car. And I said, "What were you talking about when this gun came in?" She said, "Sir, he had just told me that he had been called to preach. But he said, I don't think I'll ever preach." And she said, "The gun went off. He's dead." I went to the funeral home to see the family and saw the body. A sense of direction. Know God's will for your life.
Amen.
God has a will for every one of us. Now, get that and say, "I'll know His will for my life. I want to be in the center of the holy will of God." A sense of direction from God. I hasten on. Do you know the fullness of the Holy Spirit? That's point number 3. Do you know the fullness of the Holy Spirit? Is that missing? Are you listening? If you're a child of God, the Holy Spirit is in each one of you. He's in me. He's in your pastor. He's in your teachers. Is in your heart if you're saved. You have the Holy Spirit now. In heaven, God the Father, God the Son, but in you the Holy Spirit abides to guide you, to direct you, to empower you. Now, do you know the fullness of the Spirit? Ephesians 5:18, be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. And in Acts 4:31, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. All of them filled with the Holy Spirit. Now you can be filled. You can be filled. And God wants you to be filled. That's surrendered completely to Him and to His will. And say, Lord, fill me and empower me and use me for your glory. I preached up in Rumney, New Hampshire one morning in a very famous Bible conference ground. That's up in a big place where they have many of them, Rumney, New Hampshire. And I said something about this thing in the fullness of the Spirit, not too much, not this message, but another one. And when I walked out across the campus of that beautiful conference ground, a man came up to me. He said, sir, I heard your message. He said, I'm greatly interested in that. But he said, let me ask you something. Are you filled with the Holy Spirit now? And look to me. I had to give an answer. And if I were looking at you this morning and talking to you personally, could I ask you the question, are you filled with the Holy Spirit now? Now that fullness will come when you're fully dedicated to the Lord. When you surrender everything to Him. Huh?
Amen.
When you give up your own personal ideas and say, Lord, I want you to fill me and empower me. I want the fullness of the Spirit upon my life. That means to die to self.
Amen.
Paul said, I die daily. Young people, watch it. Your greatest problem will come from the old self-life. It's self-life makes you unhappy in the dormitory. It's self-life that makes you unhappy sometimes in classes. Huh? It's self-life that makes you an unhappy Christian in any association in the church. You've got to die to self. Die to self. Things don't always be like you want them. But you let God have His way.
Yes.
Reckon self to be dead. And don't be complaining all of the time. But die to unpleasant things and say, I want this all the way. I want to be empty of self. I'm going to be willing for God to use
Amen.
Me. I want to die to self. And then I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that fullness will bring faithfulness and courage and determination and fruit bearing when you're filled with the Spirit of God. And you can be filled. Do you know the fullness of the Holy Spirit? Now, this is not something to brag about. Not something to go talking about every day. But the Word of God teaches it. Be filled with the Spirit. And you need to know it in your own heart. That you are surrendered and He has filled you and empowered you and is making you what you ought to be and what He wants you to be. And you can be filled. I think of interesting things happening when God works. And He does work. He does work. Young people, He does work.
Yes, he does.
He supplies your needs.
Yes, He does.
Pray and wait on God.
Amen.
Don't complain, but pray and wait on God. Don't vary. Don't give up and say it can't be done. You keep on going.
Amen.
I was in a meeting down south, well, in Tampa, Florida, where it was, in a beautiful big church. Great big auditorium, almost as big as this one. And little crowds, small crowds coming. And I said, Pastor, we're not doing anything. I said, what's wrong? What can we do? What's not going well? I said, I don't know what's wrong. He said, Oral Roberts has his tenor wheel 4 blocks away. Remember the name Oral Roberts? Pentecostal healer. Many of you know him. Had a tent 4 blocks away. I went to see that tent. Man, what a tent. It would seat thousands. Great, great big thing. And the crowds were coming every night. And he was preaching and healing people. You know the way you read about it and you've seen it. And doing it all. And the crowds were, I had a little handful in that church. A little handful. And big auditorium. Nobody coming. Preacher sitting there unconcerned. And thing went on like that. And one night I spoke on the matter of the fullness of the Spirit of God. Letting God get hold of you and fill you and empower you. And use your life. I gave an invitation. And when it did, a man came out of the audience and came to the front and knelt down at the table here at the front. And I didn't say anything. We were all singing. In a moment, another man came. And then another man came. Then four of them were there. They were all praying and crying out to God. I mean, crying out loud. Oh, God, help us. Oh, God, help us. And as they were kneeling there praying, I recall something. The pastor said to me a couple days before riding through town, we saw a man walking down the sidewalk. He said, see that fellow? He's one of the devils in our church. And he said, he's mean, fights me all the time, criticizes my messages, doesn't like anything we do. And he said, he's a devil. I said, you got any more like that? He said, you got three more. I said, you need four? He said, four men. And four of the biggest devils in the country. He said, they're awful. And that night when I gave an invitation, they came down 1, 2, 3, 4. And I knew they were the four men. And they were praying and crying out to God. And the preacher standing over on one side, you see me that Bible in hand, over to one side. and just sit there. Look now, that those men as if, well, I'm good there. They need to be there. Something like that. I went back to him and said, "Preacher, I think you better join them." He said, "Not on your life." He said, "They're a dirty rascal. They've criticized me. They've done everything they can to hurt me." He said, "I'm not going." I said, "Sir, you better go." This had to be right between you and God and your church. These four men represent your church right now. You better go and be with them. I said, "If you don't go, I've just got to quit. I'll go back to the pulpit." In a moment, I saw him come off the edge of the platform like this. I went down back to these men. I saw him drop his Bible back on the back pew, coming to these four men. I watched him. Kneeling down before them. He knelt down right in the middle of the four, two on one side, two on the other, put his arm around all four of them, and began to cry. And confess his sin, "Lord, I've been wrong. I've been wrong. Oh, God, forgive me. I've criticized these men. I've found fault with these men." And they were crying and praying too. All of them were going. And all of a sudden, I looked around, the whole church crying. I mean, all of them crying. And I finally, after they had prayed a long time, I went down and said, "Gentlemen, would you like to stand and just say a word?" And one fellow spoke up the end of the line and said, "Yes, sir, I'm guilty. I'm guilty. I criticized my pastor, criticized the church, everything about it." And the fellow said, "Sir, wait a minute, next minute, I'm guilty also." And they all confessed to me. And the preacher finally confessed, "I've been wrong. I've called these men the wrong kind of names. I've been wrong in my heart toward them. And I want God to forgive me." And they stood there, had a little audience come and shake hands with them. Friday night, a little handful of people there. But what crying, what weeping, these five men there, preacher and four deacons of the church who got right. And they came and shook hands and talked for a long, long time. Closer, came back Saturday night. I could sense the difference. And the crowd had increased more than doubled. I went back to the hotel and stayed and came back Sunday morning. I drove my car over Sunday morning. I'd been parking right in front of the church, you know. A beautiful church with steps going up the front, up to the main door. And I just parked up there and parked my car. And I drove up there, and I found no place to park. I had to drive two blocks to find a parking spot. I finally found it, and I walked back to the church. I said, "What in the world is going on?" I walked up those big steps going up front of that church. When I got up there, I took over the door. When I did, a big hand reached over and got mine. I looked up, there stood a policeman. He said, "You're not going in." He said, "That building is packed in jam. The fire department sent us out here to keep anybody else from going in." So that thing is packed in jam. You can't go in. I said, "Mister, I'd like to. I'm the preacher." "Oh," he said, "excuse me." He said, "Come on, go on in." And I came inside. I walked in there. Listen, audience packed in jam, balcony full of people everywhere. I walked down the aisle. On the platform stood the pastor, crying like a baby. Crying like a baby. And I walked on the platform and he said, "I can't preach." He said, "You preach," and hand me the Bible. We opened this text that I could recognize at once, and I threw myself into the thing, gave a brief message from the Word of God, imploring people to be saved and be right with God. And that morning I saw in that one service 137 people saved in 1 hour. By name, 137 in 1 hour. And then that night again, the same thing happened. I went through Wednesday night. We had scores and scores of people saved and baptized night after night. Now, when did that happen? When people got right. The pastor and the members of the church all had to get right. Keep your heart right. Do you know the fullness of the Holy Spirit? The fullness of the Holy Spirit. Let me try once more. What is missing in your life? Do you have an overwhelming compassion for a lost world? That's number four. Compassion is our greatest need. Compassion means a knowledge of man's lost condition. The soul that sinned it shall die. He that believeth not is condemned already. Condemned already. Your son, your daughter, your mother, your father, your husband, your wife, your neighbor, your friend. What is missing in your life? Do you have an overwhelming compassion for a lost world? That will control your pocketbook, huh? That'll control your faithfulness to church. That'll control your attitude toward people when you have a compassion for a lost and dying world. Compassion means the knowledge of man's lost condition. Compassion means the knowledge of heaven and hell, the awfulness of hell and the glory of heaven. Compassion means the knowledge of the simplicity of the gospel. How simple, how beautiful it is. No man can measure it. The greatness of the gospel. We ran buses in Highland Park. Your pastor knows all about that. 35 buses we had going at one time. Beautiful, but he had charge of that for a long, long time. Hundreds and hundreds were saved. We didn't have any junior church. We'd have brought them all together. Remember that? We'd have brought them all in the auditorium. Little, young, and old. Nobody misbehaved. We never had any trouble. Never had to call a soul down. And we had a great time. But we had compassion. And people felt that. And children got saved. Many of them are in the ministry now and preaching, missionaries, and so forth. And we loved them. And people might have been forgotten by other churches. We brought them in and rejoiced in all of it. Now that's compassion, loving people, loving your friends and neighbors and winning them to the Savior. As Jesus had compassion, you must have it. What's missing in your life? Is that missing? Then say, oh God, supply that. Let me have compassion. Let me love people. Let people be saved. Let me be used to point people to the Lamb of God. Amen. I appreciate the night of Baltimore, Maryland. I forget the message I gave, but I gave an invitation, and a number got saved, and I stood there with the people, and they shook hands, and a man came by, a dignified little man, and I don't know why I did it. I just turned and said, sir, are you saved? And he stopped, shocked. He said, no, I'm not. I'm a church member. I've never been saved. I took my Bible, led that man to the Lord. He's the top employee in the U.S. government in Washington, D.C. A smart man. Educated man. Well-groomed man. Everything. But he said, no, sir, I've never been saved. I belong to the church, that's all. And God saved his soul.
Amen.
Now, compassion, compassion, compassion. We've got to see it. On your bus routes. In your Sunday school, in your church, in your visitation, in all ways, young men, young women, have compassion and let God lead you. I had a meeting in Springfield, Tennessee at one time in a little church on the side of the hill out from the First Baptist, and a big crowd was coming, mission type church, but one lady kept coming forward. She'd bring people down to the front and said, this boy got saved, this man got saved, this woman got saved, and tell about him. I finally said to somebody, said, who is that lady? Oh, that's Miss Abi Burr. Miss Burr is the cashier for the First National Bank in Springfield. Cashier. And she left the first church and came here to this mission to work with us. And winning people Sunday after Sunday, day after day. Every service, I saw Miss Abi Burr coming forward and bring people down to the front. I left, finished the meeting, went back home. I've been home for a number of days and had a phone call that Miss Abi Burr is quite ill. And I had prayer for her. And then I later had a message coming that Miss Abi Burr was dead. And they wanted me to have part in the funeral. So I drove to Springfield, the First Baptist Church. And I met the pastor, Dr. Pettigrew, went on the platform with him. And the crowd came, big crowd of people came, brought me the casket of Miss Abi Burr. And I had my part, read the scripture, and prayed, and I sat down. And the pastor got up and said, now before I speak, I'd like you ladies to stand here at the front, if you will, please. They stood up. He said, these ladies got together to say that they were individually led to Christ by Miss Abi Burr. Individually led to Christ, one by one, by Miss Abi Burr. I began counting them. I counted exactly 52 women standing at the funeral service. 52 women. Then you're saying, she led me to Christ. My friend, if you were to pass away today, how many would gather around your casket and say, he or she led me to the Lord? Have you been doing your best at it? Is that missing in your life? Salvation, direction, fullness of the Spirit, compassion, four things. Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank thee for this school and for the leadership. And for the students, all of them, I pray today that you'll help them to see if there's something missing. May they make it right. May they get the things straightened out today. If they're not compassionate and loving towards sinners, they've lost that, may they regain it. If they're not filled with the Holy Spirit, may they today say, Lord, fill me. I want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Surrender everything to Him. Father, have your way. Bless now this invitation. If you'll come, please.